What's the topic?
So the topic is, this is for my brothers and sisters. As Christians. This is for Christians. Yeah. Yeah. Because yeah. Church of England. Yeah. We love the Church of England, especially their cameraman. Okay. So what I want to talk about is the need for Christians to form koinonia communities. The reality is that when you think about how we do church today is failing, because too many Christians think that church is just meeting together on a Sunday. And no matter even if they disagree with that theologically in their mind, the reality is that that is how they are living out their Christian faith too much. So your average sort of Christian community will have dispersed groups that live out in different areas. They might practice their faith at different levels in their own daily life. They might come together for a midweek meeting, and then they might come together for a Sunday meeting. And this is not how, as Christians, we are supposed to live. I want to give you the biblical example of what church kind of looked like in the past. So if you open up to the book of Acts, and you read chapter 2, reading from verse 43, we read this. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place, though the apostles and all those who had believed were together and had all things in common. And they began selling their property and possessions and were sharing them with all as anyone might have need. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart. And if you go to chapter 4, verse 32, it reads, "And the congregation of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and not one of them claimed that anything belonged to him and was in his own, what was his own. But all things were common property to them. And with great power, the apostles were giving testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and abundant grace was upon them all. For there was not a needy person amongst them, for all who were owners of rich land or houses would sell them and bring the proceeds of the sales and lay them at the apostles' feet, and they would be distributed to each as any had need." The fundamental principle that we get, that there's some fundamental principles that we get from this teaching. Firstly, is that Christians live together in close, tight-knit communities. They lived in one another's houses. They lived close to one another. They shared a common life. Their sense of belonging to one another even went so far as that their understanding of private ownership diluted, and they saw that the things that they owned were owned together for the common good. This is what we call elective socialism. Christians are meant to live close to one another. They're meant to live lives on top of one another. They're not meant to live these disparate lives that only sort of connect with one another over a cup of tea on a Sunday. And born out of this early sense of koinonia, as the church came to represent 50% of Roman society and more than 50% of Roman society and the whole of Roman society, it obviously became impractical to stick everyone in a single commune. And so the idea of community was continued within the tradition of monasticism, and the idea that those who had committed themselves to a special life of prayer and devotion to God should come together and live in community, sharing all things in common. And we see this through the works of Saint Anthony and Saint, I think, Palomas. Maybe I got that wrong. These saints created that system of monasticism. And as monasticism grew, it was the engine that drove the Christian faith forward. It was the ark upon which Christian truth was preserved. It was the basis upon missionary effort. And wider community started to settle in and around these monastic traditions. And we saw that the early birth of lay monastic communities, like that done by Gut Geerte, or Geerte Gut, can't remember which way, who in the Netherlands gave up his family home and turned it into a house for poor and impoverished women to live in community. Christians started to move near to the monasteries so that they were living within and close to the monastic life. Now, however you want to organize it, however you feel it best to organize, the reality is for Christians to live out the values that we see in the apostolic and prophetic teaching, they must live lives close together. They must live lives that are daily commitments to one another. So I would urge you as a brother and a sister to achieve a higher perfection in your spiritual life by moving close to and into and connecting with a religious commune. Now, whether that is a monastic community or whether it's some kind of lay community, as exemplified by groups like what was the Jesus Army, where people live in commune together with a common purse, go and attach yourself to these groups. Go and live close to them. Go and interact with them. Let their life infuse yours and yours infuse theirs. The Christian life can, of course, be lived in outside of community. You think of the tradition of the hermits who live lives of isolation. Or you think of those brothers and sisters in the faith who convert in communities where they might be the only Christian for miles around. But it is harder to live out the fullness of our faith if you do it in isolation. So wherever you can, it is important that you connect yourself to a community. And that community is not something that just gathers on a Sunday. We need to reorganize the way we do church. We need to be more radical in the way that we do church. Church should be a 7-day thing.
Yeah.
Now, you can, as it were, achieve this through being porous in your sense of belonging. Have a greater sense of being a Christian and the people of God. So even if your own church doesn't meet 7 days a week, maybe there are other churches that meet on other days that you can get involved with, and thus by doing that you're connecting with Christians 7 day a week, and maybe through that you will help to draw Christians together. It is not necessary, nor is it a command, that you sell all you have and that you give all your property to the poor. However, it is a perfection, but it can only be a perfection that is lived out in community. The second strand that comes from what we've talked about is this idea of meeting the needs of the community. It says none were in want, that they looked after one another. Central to the idea of Christian praxis is that we meet the needs of our own people, that we organize ourselves in such a way that where there is a need of the Christian community, that the Christian community organizes itself to address those needs. In the New Testament church, that need was to look after orphans, to look after widows, to look after the destitute and the poor. I'm often asked by Christians, what books would I recommend to read to be a disciple? I would recommend these two for sure. One, Rich Christians in an Age of Hunger, and two, Living More Simply, which is the follow-on to the book Rich Christians in an Age of Hunger. Christians, we are called to live a simplistic life, a life in which we meet one another's needs. When Christians needed to guarantee their security, they organized themselves to do so. What are our needs? Every diocese, every parish, every fellowship needs to ask that question and needs to organize the rhythm of its fellowships, of its diocese, of its church to meet those needs. And if those needs are so great that the individual fellowship cannot meet them, then Christian fellowships need to band together until they reach such a size that they can meet them through coordination. And if that size means organizing globally, then that is what we need to do. Christians, we need to become more radical in the way we do church. At the moment, our way of doing church is constrained, and it is not meeting the needs of the community. So, challenge your bishops, challenge your pastors, challenge your vicars. Say to them that they need to do better. And if by doing better they need to coordinate with others, they need to do so. Highlight to them what our needs of the community are. And if our leaders are so incompetent that they will not meet the needs of the community, then work with the willing amongst the church, amongst the body of Christ. Organize yourselves, set up parachurch organizations, ministries to meet those needs, with or without the blessings of the incompetent bishops. I urge you, brothers and sisters, be more radical in your faith. Be more revolutionary in your faith. The world needs what we have to offer. Just one environmental point connected to that. The world cannot sustain the levels of consumerism that it currently does based upon individualism. By creating communities and communes that share things in common, we will ease the burden upon the natural resources of the world. The world needs Christian truth because it doesn't have the answers itself. So I urge you to live a radically different life, live a revolutionary life, offer that life as a different vision to society, and organize yourself to meet the needs of our community. And where that can be achieved, then be willing to share things in common.